Bartolini, thank you for joining us on Italics.
Thank you for this occasion.
It's great to have you, especially for Women's History Month.
Yes.
In your vast body of work and in your advocacy of others, of the works of others, you've done a lot, not only for Italian women writers, but women writers, writers in general, and women, through your own literature and what we'll call your proactive insistence that Italian-American women writers be heard.
Yes.
Your work has been widely recognized, lauded by the Italian-American community and by such as the New York Times Book Review and Alice Walker. Have you seen the change, the relationship change between Italian-American literature and American literature?
I have not. I hope it has, but perhaps it's taught more. I don't know because I'm not in that field. But I do know that young writers do occasionally get in touch with me and ask, you know, how do you start, what do you do, and so forth. Unfortunately, it's hard work, and in this field, without an agent, it's very hard to find a publisher. So I think it takes a lot of work, but also a lot of luck.
Let's start with your story.
Well, I've always been writing, but I always haven't been published. Mm-hmm. But after college, I had a grant to study in England. And when I was in England, I knew that what I really wanted to do was to get to Italy. I didn't want to go back after the grant was over. So I started writing travel pieces for the newspaper in Syracuse, where I come from. And that took me to Italy. And once I got to Italy, I had a letter of introduction to a journalist who perhaps could help me find material. That journalist was Antonio Bartolini. So he was helpful. And I was there for about a year. And then I came back home. But I missed Antonio, and we corresponded. And then finally, he tried to get the clearance to come over to the States. Mm-hmm. But there was such a law in that period, the McCarran Law, that they thought if Antonio had been anti-fascist, which he was during the war, he was in hiding, mm-hmm. He must be a communist. Okay. And then they wouldn't, he was not a communist. He was simply an individual who had been editor of his paper in Vicenza and had written against the fascist regime. But anyway, he couldn't come, so I went back to Italy and lived there until he became a correspondent for La Stampa, the newspaper in Turin, mm-hmm. and then we came to New York.
And you were translating his works?
Yes, that developed afterwards.
And when did you become a published writer of your own accord?
I had been writing articles for my Syracuse, New York mm-hmm. paper, so those were published. And my first books were books of poetry. I think everybody sort of starts with poetry. And then after that came the grant from the National Endowment for the Arts, from which I could start a full-length work, which was Umbertina.
You were saying earlier that if it hadn't been for that grant, you don't know if you would have been able to.
I don't see how I could have.
What would you have done if you didn't?
Well, I was working in the library. I was bringing up a family. I was translating Antonio. I had plenty of things to do.
You didn't have time to get bored.
No.
So we were talking earlier about the relationship change between Italian-American literature and American literature. And you said about the hardships. What about as far as genre is concerned between Italian-American and American? Have you seen any change?
Well, I don't even know if Italian-American literature exists. I don't know if it's taught in colleges as such. I think it must have peaked, I really do, because I think that those authors should be recognized as American authors. They're writing in English. They should have a wider audience. Mm-hmm. I can't think that any other ethnic group has to have its own classification. I think that we are American authors, and our subject is our ancestry and our material.
What are your feelings on the development of Italian-American literature?
Well, I didn't know that this even existed. When I was growing up, I didn't know there was such a thing as Italian-American literature. I was just reading everyone. Mm-hmm. And how did I first? It was probably by going to many of those conferences that they held that I became aware that this was a whole separate genre. Mm-hmm. And that intrigued me because I felt that we hadn't a representation. We weren't known in American literature. But I see us as part of American literature.
In 1990, I believe you were on a panel with Anthony Tamburi and others for the presentation of the anthology From the Margin.
From the Margin.
And there you emphasized that the Library of Congress should categorize that book's content as American literature. Why would that be so important?
Oh, because that's a much wider field. Mm. We are Americans, and what we write is American literature. Mm. And I think by making another category, it sort of diminishes the attraction it would have for everyone.
Mm. Your groundbreaking anthology, The Dream Book, was the first anthology of Italian-American writers who are all women. Even though you publish it with Shokin, who is excellent, but we might assume, as with any other endeavor, that there were challenges.
Well, I felt very fortunate that Shokin really wanted to take it on, because I thought it was a difficult subject to launch. I don't know how many in the wider public would be interested in just Italian-American women writers. But I felt that there were a number of us who hadn't been recognized, and we were present, and that if we were all brought together in one place, that gave us a distinction and a following.
In your original introduction of the same anthology, The Dream Book, in the section titled The Historical and Social Context of Silence, you begin, and I'm quoting, a question to ask rather than why Italian-American women were silent so long is what were the conditions that impeded the act of writing. Can you tell us about those conditions and how they changed for you personally and for others?
Well, I think Italian-American women, going way back to when they first got here, were workers. Mm-hmm. They had to work to survive here. And then there was family. And then it was the tradition itself. I mean, Italian tradition is very hard for women, I think, in some ways. They were thought to be the mothers, the caretakers, the family, the home. There was a lot of that here among Italian Americans. Mm-hmm. But I think that that's pretty much disappeared. I don't think that there is that any longer.
What are the conditions that impede writing now? Are they different from when you started or when those
now,
before you
started? Now, there's just much more competition. Uh-huh. And there are fewer publishers, unfortunately. Uh-huh. And also, there's great emphasis on mass market. And I think that maybe our material seems too restricted.
And the same thing as we were saying before about because it's Italian-American.
Right.
And that it won't appeal to a wider audience. Why do you think that Italian-American literature hasn't been accepted as American literature?
Not enough.
Yeah.
I think it just has to be taught and more disseminated because I just don't think people are aware of it.
Have you ever thought of how it should be disseminated more?
Well, somebody's got to have a great bestseller like Mario Puzo did. Mm-hmm. And, that should have, in a way, opened up for the rest of us. Mm. But I don't think it did enough.
Yeah, it's strange because it kind of opened up the mafia genre, unfortunately, because he had, that's not all his work, right? He's got more genre.
Yeah, because his Fortunate Pilgrim isn't that well known.
Right. And that would have, if that had been the book,
yes,
that kind of made it,
right,
things would have been different. Can you imagine the stories?
We all have
in
stories.
In literature, film, yeah. Now let's come to Umbertina. Your novel has received critical acclaim and is considered one of the best coming out of the Italian-American community. Some see it as one of the classics, in league with Pietro di Donato's Christ in Concrete and Puzo's The Fortunate Pilgrim. And the novel has also been translated to Italian.
Yeah.
What place does it hold for you within your own body of work?
Well, I always thought of it more as a feminist novel than an Italian-American novel, because the main protagonists are women, and they're women who achieve something. Mm. And I think that's what I was thinking of, because when it was written, it was in the times when the women's movement was very strong. Mm. And it was something that I very much believed in.
Were you doing this through your writing, or were you also like out in the streets and or with women fighting for...
Well, yes, somewhat, but, you know, I live in a small community, and we don't go out in the streets very much.
Yeah, but that was also, that was already a great feat, because when I read, and I'm sure when many women read Umbertina, it probably had the same effect. It's kind of, it's a very liberating, especially for an Italian-American woman, it's liberating, and it's anchoring at the same time. It gives you that connection to your roots and that strength, which you talk about. You talk about this quite often, or it comes up often. I have it later in my questions, but I guess we'll get to it because I want to ask you this next question. But the theme of the grandmother and those kind of connecting back to the grandmother. Do you consider Umbertina your best novel?
Oh, well, you know, I'm sort of fond of all of them. And really, the most recent one is the one that I am most involved with. Mm-hmm. Umbertina seems to me now already so long ago, and it's been accepted, and I have to push the others a little bit. Mm-hmm. But yes, as the first novel, yes, of course, that's always going to be the firstborn.
Yeah, I was going to say, I don't know if it's anti-feminist for us to say the first child, right?
Yeah, right?
And then also these other creations are kind of, I don't know how men would say it, but they're like, they're kind of, maybe it's the same for men. It's like they're like birthing a new child, kind of, right?
Well,
I don't know,
yeah,
if it feels the same.
It was very important for me. It was a real breakthrough to have that accepted and published.
In your essay, The Way of the World, in which you trace the life paths as parallel or non-parallel between that of your father and that of F. Scott Fitzgerald, who grew up in the same town, but on opposite sides of the class spectrum.
Exactly.
You write in that essay, quote, given the Fitzgerald home address in Syracuse, Scott would have gone to mass with his observant Catholic parents at nearby St. John's Church, which is where my father's parents, both immigrants from Sicily, were married. Not upstairs in the church proper, where the Irish practiced their Christian devotions, but downstairs in the basement, which was the place for Italians.
Yes.
When I think of those little boys of a century ago entering the church on different, highly symbolic levels, I'm still offended, even though I understand that it no longer pertains, that times have changed, that such practices have died. You also describe similar circumstances in Umbertina. Do such class divisions still make you mad?
Well, they would if they existed now, but I don't believe that they do.
For Italian Americans, you mean, or other?
For Italian, yeah. for anybody, yeah. But I have not been back to Syracuse to attend Mass at St. John's for many, many years, but I don't believe that practice is still in.
No, I would hope
no,
not.
No, it couldn't be.
No. I meant more like, you know, I guess as Italian Americans, maybe some of us, and someone like you, feminist, who's seeing, you know, the social context of the world, and, you know, and has utilized and has spoken to this through your writing, you know, perhaps sometimes we can see also how it pertains to other ethnicities, like, you know, Black youth who are highly imprisoned at alarming rates.
Yes.
Things like that's what I meant more like, yes. That, like, you know, when you see this happening to other people,
yes.
Does that still enrage you?
Of course, yes. Yes, anything that's unfair.
In Umbertina, you talk about Marguerite's and perhaps all women's need to have their own identity. You say in the book, she had no official presence with which to impress people and help them recognize her, and yet she did. And then you go on to list details of her accomplishments and her losses and her hopes. This is a quote from the book. And still no one saw her. She could no more exist alone than does a painting without viewers or the Grand Canyon without tourists. Her existence depended on others. How could she get them to know, by Jesus, that she was here? This is reflective of your introduction to the most recent edition of the Dream Book regarding the acknowledgement of Italian-American women writers, and it's a recurring theme. What does it mean on a societal level that marginalized people's voices be heard?
Well, we've had the feminist movement since then. Mm-hmm. I think things have come around. Mm-hmm. But there was a time when it was very hard for women to be perceived in their own right. Mm-hmm. They were always the accessory. They were the wife, the mother, so on, but, you know. But I think that has very much changed. I mean, I see it in my own daughters. They don't feel any of this that I felt growing up.
And is that because of you as a mother, or do you think the
no,
world...
No, because of the times.
Uh-huh. What do you think the world would be like if we didn't have this breakthrough?
Oh, it would be impossible. I mean, really. Mm-hmm. I mean, you have to advance. One has to think that in life one advances. Right. It doesn't stay the same.
Right, yeah.
No, that would be impossible.
Yeah. We mentioned before, the grandmother is also a recurring consideration in your work. From Umbertina, this is a quote. Marguerite wondered if her own fears were worse now than those faced by that Calabrian peasant, her grandmother. She says, I always fantasized about my grandmother. I always thought I wanted to get back to her elementary kind of existence, her kind of primitive strength. Do we carry this strength of the immigrant women with us?
I hope so, in a different way, maybe, more modernized. But I think we have learned from the past. That's what we should do.
Do you carry it with you? I mean, you said that you've mentioned that you didn't really know your grandmother, but that image of her and this wanting to know who she was.
I think so. I think that's what led me to go off on my own, go to Europe, go to Italy, and do what I did.
Mm-hmm. Why do we continue to dream about these grandmothers and wish to travel back in time to live the lives they led?
Oh, I wouldn't want to lead life. I want progress. I want us to keep advancing. Mm-hmm. I see them as symbols, and I see them as reinforcing our own dreams to go ahead, mm-hmm. and admire their strength and what they had to overcome. But I wouldn't want to be them.
What meaning does this have beyond the Italian-American community? If we want to be considered American literature, what does it mean that in that context of American and not unrecognized other, writing from the point of view of Italian-American experience? You say about Umbertina, what was her story? Who is she? And I knew all those years later that was the story I wanted to write. This unrecognized other, it kind of... If these books are not coming out, if they're not published and available to a wide audience, then the actual people themselves are become kind of invisible.
Exactly, yes. Well, because I always had this thought of my grandmother, with whom I could not communicate at all. And she was always this woman in the kitchen, mm-hmm. doing the cooking. and we were the family out in the other rooms, being very festive and everything. Mm-hmm. And I always thought, who is this woman in the kitchen? She's my grandmother, but who is she? I couldn't speak to her. All I could say was, "Come stai, Grandma?" Mm-hmm. And then she would pat me, you know, and bene, bene. But no, I had to create her. Mm. I had to create her for myself, really, because I wanted to know her story. She couldn't talk to me, and I couldn't talk to her, but I knew from where she came. So I studied a bit of the immigration from Calabria and the background of the people there. I went to Calabria.
Mm. To Castagna, where she was from?
Yes, yes. I saw, you know, the hard life those people had. And I could understand why they came in droves to America.
Mm-hmm. When was it that you went there? What do you remember what year?
It was, I believe it was 1959. Oh. I drove there with my cousin, who she was on a Fulbright. She had come to Italy on a Fulbright. I was living in Rome. So when she got there, I said, "Let's go find our grandmother." And we did.
And did you find relatives there when you went?
No, I didn't find any relatives. But I saw the place, yeah, and I saw how she would have lived. Uh-huh. And I went to visit the priest, and he told me, you know, about the customs of the times and all that. So,
and from there you began constructing her story?
Yes.
4 decades later, if you were about to embark on your first literary work now, what would it be?
That's a very hard question, because Umbertino was very pressing on me because I had lived in Italy. I had gone to where she came from. Mm-hmm. I had seen the environment and the people and all that. So that was natural to start from there. Mm-hmm. But if I were going to start now, maybe I wouldn't even do an Italian-American novel. I don't know. That's fascinating question. Maybe I would do more of a woman's story, but not particularly an Italian-American. I don't know.
Just because Umbertino was so important.
It was very important then.
What will we do without it?
But it was of its time. It was a time when we were getting back to roots. Remember roots?
Yeah.
And so that was very powerful. We were all thinking, oh, well, what is roots in my life? You know, and we were getting back to that.
Mm-hmm. What were some of the challenges then, living in Italy and in that particular time?
Oh, I loved living in Italy. It was my golden age. No, really. I mean, with Antonio, we traveled around because he was writing for La Stampa, and we would go to writers' conferences, and it was just wonderful. I mean, in that circle, we knew all the writers, wow. Montali, Calvino, everybody, wow. You know, really, it was very inspiring.
I can't wait to read the memoir.
Oh, it hasn't even begun. I've got to start it.
One more thing. What are your thoughts on how Italians view Italian Americans?
Oh, they were not very welcoming. It seemed to be, I mean, this is not recent, this is going way back, but they seemed to think that it was the lower class, the ones who left, and that was good. Mm. Let them go.
Recently, one of my coworkers heard someone saying, "Oh, you're Italian from Italy, you're real then."
So there still is sort of a feeling.
Yeah, it's still there. So maybe we'll get rid of it now that we have all these young Italians coming over again. There's like
a new... Well, as a matter of fact, yes, I have often thought that in a way, I uplifted myself by marrying a real Italian who was already professionally known and was an accepted writer. Mm-hmm. If I had gone there just as myself, an Italian-American, it would have been different, I think.
As far as that is concerned, I'd really, in the 2000s, I had no problem.
But you're a filmmaker.
Yeah,
You were somebody who has a profession.
As a woman, though, it was very difficult. Bad.
Really? Have yeah. I made no progress?
Very little.
I think that's a disaster. I think that's awful.
When I asked you that, what would we have done if things hadn't changed? Because we have people like you that really have these voices out there, it makes all the difference.
Well, I see that in my daughters. They have no restrictions. They can do whatever they want. Mm-hmm. And I think that's wonderful.
It's right.
Yeah, it's right. Oh, I want to thank you. I want to thank you especially for this interest in Umbertina. It's always very welcoming to me to hear that people can still relate to that.
Yeah.
And I am working now on my memoir. So hopefully I'll get that done.
Really looking forward to that. Thank you. Thanks so much for joining us.
Thank you.